So first off, I guess you guys probably know what a game means. Be a little hard if you didn't know what that meant, but you know, gay guys, gay girls, gay people. It's pretty self-explanatory. Woo. Gay. Now there are sexualities that are kind of in the middle. All right. So there are bisexual people, people who are attracted to both genders. All right. Fair enough. All right. We're going. And now there's pansexual. Those are people who are more attracted to the person than any sort of specific gender or gender-defining features they have. Cool beans. All right. Now there are. I think that kind of fits for that type of thing. And there are asexual people, who are people that feel no sexual attraction to anybody. Then there are gray asexual people, who tend to have no sexual attraction to anybody, for the most part. Sometimes that can change, fair enough. That's that. Now, there is gender identity. That is which gender you identify as. So there are the standard gender identities, which are male and female. There's also gender non-conforming, gender queer, agender, and gender fluid. Thank you. Sorry, there are a lot of them. And all of those kind of fit under the same umbrella of not exactly fitting into the molds of male or female. Some of them are more, not severe, but they differentiate themselves. Agender is kind of feeling like, oh, you know, like neither of these really apply to me at all, and I'm going to stay away from them, you know. Then there's gender fluid, which you're like, maybe you feel like a dude today, maybe you don't, maybe you feel like a girl today, whatever. Then there is gender nonconforming, which is a bit like agender, where you're just like, who really cares? The gender fluid umbrella, it kind of all fits under the same thing, where you're just like, gender's here, whatever. It's not really a big thing. Then there are transgender people who feel like they don't, their gender identity does not quite correlate with their birth sex, you know. I think you guys all kind of get that, right? Nod, or shake, or something. You know, a sixth. That's good. That's good. More than I thought beforehand. Then just so you know, cisgender, those are people whose gender identities correlate with their birth sex. So cool. And then there are pronouns, and just the base core ones that you guys need to know, which I'm pretty sure you guys do know. There are 8. All right. He, him, his. She, her, hers, and they, oh, no, 9, they, them, theirs, all right? They, them, theirs is used for gender non-conforming people, all right? Alrighty, now, let's, guys, introduce yourselves.
Just
name and pronouns.
I'm Britt, I'm a junior, and I don't really have a preference for pronouns.
I'm Ellen, I'm a senior, and I use she, her, hers.
I'm Blake, I'm a freshman, and I use they, them, their pronouns.
I'm Glenn, I'm a junior, and I use they, them, their pronouns.
I'm Andrew, I'm a sophomore, and I use he, him, his pronouns.
Alrighty. Now, I'm going to ask all of you, which part of the LGBTQ plus spectrum do you guys identify as?
You first.
So, gender-wise, I was obviously born male, but I identify more towards feminine. I wouldn't say all the way, but definitely more that way. And then, as far as sexuality goes, I don't care. I'm into human beings.
All right. One thing I want to explain first is that queer is kind of an umbrella term for people on the spectrum, and it has been used as a slur and kind of hate speech in the past, but people like us are kind of reclaiming that term, so don't be afraid of the word, but don't use it in a mean way, please. So I identify as queer, and specifically I'm gay, so I'm a woman who likes other women. So another word for that is lesbian, but I prefer the term gay. And gender-wise, like I said, I'm a woman, but I don't think of myself as the same type of woman as other women. like, I think we're all our own type of woman, and for me, that means that my expression of my gender is more masculine and androgynous, which means kind of in the middle and unisex. So, for example, I don't wear dresses except for when I play with the wind ensemble. And I will probably wear a suit to prom. So, more queer gender.
You might be leading into question five.
All right, then. More queer gender-wise than what, you know, society expects of a woman. And expression of gender is distinct from your actual identity, so that's me.
I identify as agender, and I like females, which I just categorize as gay.
I'm gender fluid. I also like the ladies and non-binary people.
I already introduced myself, but I see myself as a transgender male, and I'm on the other side more of a gay male, so I'm in the dudes.
Someone else.
Bolivians, frijoles frescos, espanol. Personally, I'm bisexual. You know, that's just kind of a, you know, I'm chill about it. I don't necessarily care about things that often. Unless you talk to me about Star Wars, I don't care about that many things. And then I get angry.
And Star Trek's better.
You know, I would have a certain response to you involving death and fire, but, you know.
Thank you.
Since this is a school panel, you know, yeah. All right. So, next question. How have your experiences as an LGBTQ plus identifying person, how have they shaped you to who you are today?
For me, I haven't had too many bad experiences, but it's been a lot of more good experiences. It's got me a lot more active in politics. I'm wearing a shirt from an organization I worked with for about a year. I've worked with student organizations, with legal organizations, with community organizations, and I think more than anything, it's made me a better leader and a better student. And I haven't had any really awful experiences. I know people who have, but my personal experience has just been helping the rest of the community.
I kind of agree with Brittany. Like, being in sort of a historically oppressed group has helped me relate to other historically oppressed groups and work sort of with activism for them. You know, for people who are of different races, religions, disabilities, and such. I also haven't really had bad experiences. I think mostly because I didn't realize I was gay until like eighth grade, which is a little bit late, but you can realize anytime, no judgment. But part of that is that there hasn't been a lot of queer representation in the media. So, you know, as a child, I didn't always see people who seemed like me in the media when I was watching TV or whatever. So that's kind of changing, but that's a slightly negative experience, which, you know, I hope changes for kids in the future.
I agree with Ellen, and being part of such an accepting community helps you realize that not everyone in the world is completely unaccepting, and you become a lot more confident when you're in such an accepting community and you can express yourself however you want to.
I do agree that the LGBTQ community is very accepting, but outside of it, there has been some of my experience have not been as pleasant. Because one time I was walking to the library with my girlfriend at the time, and this man just came up to us and told us that we were what's wrong with this world. And I mean, like, me in love with my girlfriend and not, I don't know, war, death, stopping people. Now it's two people in love. But other than that, really, it has been getting much better and easier to go around and feel love for anyone.
I kind of more experiences on your side, as in, like, I do it's been more like some offhand comments, not like straight up like harassment. People are like, is that a boy or a girl? I'm like, honey, I don't know either. But it's just like microaggressions like that, like just small things like, oh, like tranny. But I'm like, yeah, but also
I don't quite know if that's a microaggression. That's more so a slur.
Yeah. I just couldn't speak. And then also there's like bathroom stuff, and I did a presentation on that.
The statistic where no trans person has been caught committing any sexual assault in bathrooms, and statistically more probable that somebody who's been fighting against bathroom laws have, you know, done that more. So
yeah.
A little statistic for you guys to look up. Fun times.
So I feel like that's just more of a my own personal fear that no one's ever acted on.
Yeah. Well, personally, I don't have many troubles because, you know, I am a cis white dude. So there aren't many troubles for me in the world. It's kind of like a responsibility for, you know, white guys to kind of like understand, like, oh, hey, maybe, you know, we don't experience the same amount of stuff that other people who aren't exactly like us experience, you know. I've had one run-in where, like, I was talking about, like, I was bisexual, and, like, this is in middle school, and this one kid who I've later found out is a skinhead. So, a skinhead in at the time, 2014, fun times. Just talking about how, like, you know, dropped the cursive F-bomb a couple times, and just talking about, again, what was wrong in the world. And it's like, yo, dude, like, we're in Memorial. This place has, like, 15,000 cameras going on at the same time. I can go down to the office and I can just tell them to look at the cameras. And just like, what? No, you can't do that. You can't do that. And I'm like, they can. And she's like, yo, man, that's not cool. And he walks away. You know, I think it's kind of the thing that you need to do with people who are being aggressive towards you as an LGBTQ plus person. You just have to kind of be smarter than them. Like, nothing fears a stupid person more than intellect.
So when Parker admitted his privilege as being a white guy, if you two are white or a dude or you're straight or you're cisgender, then maybe, you know, think about the privileges that you have in this world that you might not think about every day, and, you know, you can use that privilege to elevate the voices of people who don't have it. That's just some advice.
So since questions 2 and 3 just kind of got intermixed there, I'm going to ask you guys, how do you guys like to express your gender identity, or just express yourself, like, at all? Like, me personally, you know, I don't kind of, like, kind of touching on, like, what Ellen was saying earlier with, like, feeling like she's, like, not the typical kind of girl. I'm not necessarily the typical kind of guy. I don't like facial hair. I don't like having short hair, mainly because my head looks like a potato when I have short hair. I don't like having short hair, nevertheless.
Do you like having eyebrows?
Short subject. Very short subject. Anybody who knows that story, you know, events led to me not having eyebrows for a hot second, and that wasn't fun. They hurt growing back, but yes, I do enjoy having eyebrows, so thanks, Brett. Yeah.
Oh, I'm answering your question.
Yeah, sure are.
So my expression is varied depending on situation and comfort. I mean, for formal events, sometimes I do dresses, sometimes I do tuxes. I don't really care. I don't have a huge preference. And I just kind of flip-flop whenever I feel like it. I think at some point I'll switch more one way than the other, but for now I don't have a real set expression, and I switch around. Like last night for wind ensemble, I wore a tux, but I did makeup, so it's just like, whatever.
For me, like I said, my style is more unisex and masculine at times. And something that's been difficult about that is shopping. I really don't like shopping, mostly not because I don't like clothes at all, but because I don't like the clothes that I grew up seeing in the women's section or the girls' section of a store. So, you know, I found what I like in time, and, you know, both sides of the store have button-down shirts, which I appreciate. But marketing towards people, clothing-wise, has been a very binary experience, so I think anyone who's not quite comfortable in that Barbie mold can tell you that it's a little bit tough, especially when there's a style that you like, but it doesn't fit you because you don't have the right chromosomes for, you know, the clothing.
I agree with that. It's I don't really have a preference when it comes to clothes. I just mainly wear flannels, but it has been hard wanting to wear something that is usually seen for more masculine people and not being able to wear it because it doesn't fit my body type. So that's definitely been a hard thing, but I don't really care when it comes to clothes. I just wear whatever I want.
I mostly wear hoodies because, as you can see, because they really hide most things that I don't like about my body, like my chest and my curves. But my problem about shopping is that, similar with you two, is that I don't like the style of the women's clothing because I don't feel comfortable in it. But when I go into the men's section, I'm too small to wear anything in there, and I'm lucky if I can find like one thing that somewhat doesn't hide all my leg and doesn't look like a dress on me on the men's section. And it's just a pain to go shopping to find something I feel comfortable in, and it's difficult. I don't know how else to explain it.
I feel like clothes are gender neutral, but there's definitely the stigma of people will be like, that's a dress, it's female, and that's like, I don't know, flannels, masculine. And I feel like I wear whatever I want, but whatever I want is mostly like t-shirt and jeans. And that's like, I do like makeup a lot. Like, I'll do makeup on off days, but I don't usually wear it to school because I like don't want to get called female. But I do enjoy doing makeup. I guess that's it.
Yeah, so you make a good point that clothes don't have gender. People have gender.
Yeah.
But, you know, at the same time, like, if I want to wear a tux to prom, I can't walk into Men's Warehouse and pick whatever style I want and my size and have it, you know, not be like too wide here and too tight here. So
I just went to Men's Warehouse and I couldn't fit anything, and it was ridiculous because shoulders came out here, my end came up to like my knees. Couldn't do it. It's
difficult.
Mike's, that's the only way I would fit.
Mike talks out.
Men's Warehouse. Alright, whatever. Alright, so I think this is going to be a bit of a gold mine. What are your guys' thoughts on regarding cultural gender norms?
A bunch of crap.
Alright, so I started thinking about this one before, and my original response has been censored because it wasn't appropriate. But I have switched my response, and I think they're a bunch of nonsense because human brain expresses itself in a million different ways, and like we have scientifically proven that gender goes beyond just your mind. It's like people who are trans, their brains work more like the sex that they identify with than the one they were born with. So it's like, why do we have a cultural binary of gender when the brain doesn't even fit that same dichotomy? And in other cultures, there are other genders as well, so it's not a new concept to be defying the norms of this culture, but I just don't believe that it has any relevance. And I think also, as
science advances, so it's not as necessary to have one man and one woman to produce a child, that it's going to break down even more.
Nice. I think, you know, Brittany said a lot of what there is to say. I don't know if you guys have heard the phrase, gender is a social construct, but it is, which means it's not really real, in the binary at least, and almost the existence of a gender at all, you know, because there's such a spectrum that there aren't two boxes, there aren't even any boxes, there's just a whole mess of feelings. So I think that, you know, cultural gender norms are kind of rooted in the traditions that we learned about in AP World History, where the ladies, you know, raised some crops and their children, and the guys hunted animals. And yeah, I think we're past that, at least in America right now. So we should try to, you know, see both genders slash all
the
more than two.
I think the coasts are.
Yeah,
like
the coasts are past now. Yeah, so, you know, a man or a woman or a gender nonconforming person can have any role that they want.
I agree with that. And in the sense of, like, expressing yourself, I have always had a hard time understanding why some things seem more masculine and some things seem more feminine. Like, clothes are just a piece of cloth. Like, why does that have to be male or female? That's always been a hard thing to understand. Or, yeah, like, color, but it's just a color. Like, why is pink seen as feminine and blue seen as masculine? So, I think you should be able to identify however you want and not have to worry about other people judging you because you feel like they might not take you seriously anymore if you are trans, say masculine, and you're wearing something feminine, and you're scared people might not take your gender seriously anymore.
Talking about the colors, I find it interesting that I believe before World War II, the colors of the genders were switched, so men were pink and blue were ladies. So just showing how it has changed, colors don't have genders, because it can just switch just by the culture that we are in today.
I feel like Brittany said it really well, as in, like, even scientifically there's been proven that there's more than two genders. Like, it's possible, and the brain works differently. And I feel like socially it's tiring, and I don't want to have to keep up with it. I'm kind of just tired of it.
Fair enough. Firstly,
we have a question.
Oh, you do? Oh.
Is there
anyone
who has questions?
Yes.
Yeah, awesome. Fair enough.
Anyone can ask questions.
Yeah.
Cool.
Forgot to say that, but sorry.
Do you feel like there's anything or anywhere that genderization pulls any water? Like, is there any time or place, you know, we kind of eliminated things like colors, but are there any places where gender actually does have some sort of defining role?
I mean, generally, like, not less developed places, but, like, there are places that aren't as, like, culturally evolved as the U.S., you know. Look at Russia. We're all looking at Russia at the moment, but still. It, like, they have fines for, like, they have fines against gay people. Like, you are literally fined if you are gay. Men are, like, what is it? Like, they passed another law where, like, men are, like, allowed to domestically abuse wives. And gender roles are super defined there because they rely a lot on Christianity. Look at their TV shows. They're all super Christian, which is weird.
Is there any positive way?
Like, I still think even then, like, I think that's a bad enforcement of it. I don't think that's a, like, it shouldn't be obligated of the people. I think it's just
that's the way the government wants it and the institutions that are in power there. I don't think that it needs to be in place to keep order or something like that. I don't really have any place. And I'm not, and I believe that like gender has a role if you want it to have a role. If you want to have a family with a man, a woman, and children, go ahead and do it, but I don't, and we, a lot of us don't. And it's like, family should define itself on its own. It shouldn't be defined by someone.
Yeah.
And what I define my family as is probably a lot different than what he does or any of them or any of you do, and it should be on an individual basis.
Yeah, and I would like to say that there is kind of a positive use for gender-based things, like in the movement of feminism. I think it is important for women as a historically oppressed group of people to have a gendered space to come together and push for progress. I think what's most important is that that gendered space is accepting of people who are trans women, people who are not men or women, people who are women of color, people who are female and are immigrants, people who are female and have disabilities. So if you do it right, you can come together in either gender or no gender, but like you can have a positive effect from a gendered space as long as you do it right and accept, you know, all people.
Well, it feels like what you just said, it kind of also feels like you said that men cannot also be feminists because it's a gender.
I didn't say that.
No, but I mean, like it's a gendered space in feminism, but it's also not because it can also have men in there.
Right. I was mostly thinking of like next year I'm probably gonna end up at a women's college, which has both trans women and trans men and gender non-conforming people at it. But
where are you going?
Probably soon. But I meant that like there is some comfort, at least to me as a woman, in a space that is predominantly women or people who have some oppressed experience gender-wise.
Okay.
But men are definitely should be included in feminism, and you can be a feminist if you're a man.
Yeah, and I think that goes back to what I was saying a bit. It's like, that is a good example. I agree, like, you can find comfort in that, but it's like, it's doing it by choice. You want to be in that body of people. It's not that you're being forced into it. It's a choice, and that's what the difference there is.
Also, I'm just gonna apologize to somebody at the moment because I said something about Christianity. And what I'm going to retract at the moment is that Russian Orthodoxy is a bit strict. It's like really strict, and it's a little no bueno for gay people there. So that's all I'm gonna say at the moment.
Okay, I agree with Britt and Ellen, and in the fact that like if you want to have your own gender norms, I guess, then go ahead, like, but don't force them on other people. Like, if you want to follow it and you want to like believe that you have gender norms and that you want that to be like that, like don't put your beliefs on other people. Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah.
Basically, yeah, I don't know what else to add. They did it pretty nicely.
Yeah. Next question. What are your views on the fluidity of sexual attraction and gender identity? So, you know, they're goldmine.
It's a thing.
Yeah, they're both, I'd say they're both very fluid, dependent on person more so. My definitely sexuality is fluid. I go through phases where I'm interested in different people, and it just works that way. Same way with my partner, we both just kind of flip around who we're interested in, but it works out. And as far as gender goes, I don't really subscribe. I'm just set where I am. I don't need any little check boxes, so I'm not the person to talk about it. I do believe that it does. In some people, it isn't a solid state. It moves, but I'm not that person, so I'm not going to speak about it.
Yeah, I agree. I'll pass because I'm not the best authority that you have in front of you to speak on fluid identities.
I myself used to identify as gender fluid, and then I realized I wasn't, and it was just I liked some different types of clothing. But I believe you can identify however you want to identify, and no one should be able to take that away from you.
Okay, so I'm gender fluid. I am basically the pinnacle of gender fluidity, because I can go from, not always, but from day to day, I can, my gender can kind of switch very rapidly, which is not the, how rapidly my gender can, can switch is not as normal as like some other genders where it stays and then like over years it can kind of slowly move to a different gender. Because last week I felt very masculine, like I binded, I did some, I stuffed, which is basically trying to make it look like I have a bulge in my crotch to make it look like I'm more masculine than my body would actually normally be shown. But now, this week, I am much more agender, meaning I don't really do anything, I just look what I do, I wear, like.
You look like a quilt.
I look like a gun because I don't really identify as having a gender at the moment, but.
Well, see, when you say like maybe it's just like weird like vocabulary stuff with terminology.
Yeah.
But you're saying your gender changes rapidly. Maybe it's more so how you express your gender.
Yes and no. It's very hard to explain if you do not actually feel it, because I do change my expression quite rapidly as my kind of. As my mental gender kind of changes, but this week has been extraordinary weird for my gender, because most of the time I can go months on end and my gender doesn't change at all.
But when you feel like a certain way, do you switch to like pronouns or do you just
no.
stick to they?
I just stick to they them, but. Just making sure this is clear, my gender fluid is not everyone's gender fluid. Because gender fluid is fluid, it's different for everyone. There can be people who only switch between female and male and can switch their pronouns from when they switch, when they feel like one gender is more what they identify as another. And as a gender fluid person, they should be also telling you or showing you signs of what they're feeling that day is marking.
Would you say it's respectful to use, like, primarily when you're talking about that person, they, them pronouns?
Because you have to talk to them. It's
like,
not my decision.
But, like, as, like, generally, everything's not, like, down to a person-to-person basis. But, like, as more so an all-encompassing, like, hey, like, you know, you want to be respectful no matter what, but, like, I take small issues with, like, little vocabulary stuff that the LGBTQ plus community has, where, like, everything's kind of scattered. Not a lot of things are definite, all right? So a lot of things change,
well,
a lot of terms kind of go in and out of use.
Yeah,
you just kind of have to deal with that.
Growing as a society, like as a group,
yeah,
everything
but,
changes.
But sometimes there could be a bit too. We've kind of gotten to the point where it's a little hard for people who don't.
If what you're, what I'm getting, and not to be on the offense, but as the person on the panel who does legal work, I am the offense most of the time on the panel. I'm blunt. I'll admit to it. I'm probably the bluntest person on the panel. It seems like, can you just disregard it for the sake of keeping things tidy?
Well, language kind of needs to be tidy most of the time. And also, just like there kind of needs to be standards with LGBTQ plus language, because nobody really wants to be offensive. Nobody really wants to be.
I don't know. I don't think there needs to be a standard. I don't think you even need to be a member of the community. You can identify as a queer identity and avoid the community for whatever reason.
I feel like instead of changing the language, we should just educate people.
Thank you.
Because, like, this is what the panel's for. If these people don't understand the terms, like, you learn new words. And there are a lot of new words. And it can be really confusing, and I know that, especially because I have a lot of family who don't understand. Even friends who are like, hey, what does any of this mean? I'm like, oh, well, here's an explanation. And I feel like it's not your job, or it's not like a job you have to explain it to people.
If we're all human beings here, which we are, unless somebody here is an alien.
There's no politicians.
You caught me. I'm actually an alien.
Yeah, fair enough. No, hail Xenu. No, that's not a culture joke. We're all people, all right? Like, we just kind of have to work with each other.
Yeah.
And if we, like, with a lot of other marginalized groups, you don't see the amount of verbs and
but
nouns.
It's not like there isn't room in the language. There's a word for picking someone up and throwing them out the window. I can defenestrate you. There is a word for that. Why can't we be fluid in? Why can't we be fluid in vocabulary if there's a word for throwing people out windows? How many of you have actually said you've defenestrated someone? No one. I can't even say it.
Yeah, Parker, I hear you saying that we should work together with other people, but I don't hear you respecting the wishes of many in our community who have certain words they'd like use for them, certain, like Glenn said, Glenn can't speak for all gender fluid people. Glenn can't say these are the pronouns that you should use for a gender fluid person. Glenn can only say these are the pronouns you should use for me.
This all kind of started from the topic of if there's a gender fluid person and their gender, they feel like they can change pronouns from like time to time, and people don't necessarily know what pronouns that they would be using. And most of the time when you're talking about people like using their pronouns, all right, it's normally when that person is not in the room, all right. So most of the time when you're using pronouns, you don't necessarily know what they are feeling that day. So would it be better to use they, them, theirs?
It's depending on the person. They should be telling you, if I'm not there, use this pronoun, unless I tell you otherwise.
We have a question.
Yes, definitely.
Don't be afraid to ask somebody. It's never an offensive question.
Yeah, like, if somebody's like, what pronouns do you use? Or like, how do you identify? I'm like, oh my god, thank god.
It's not offensive to ask. It's an amazing feeling if you come up to me and be like, what is your pronouns? And I will openly say that I am they, them, and those are my pronouns, and they won't change.
And I think with that, we should move on to the next question, because we were supposed to be an educational panel, not a debate panel. I love debate, I love politics, but it's not the top.
Yo, question?
So, sexuality and gender is a very, very intimate and personal subject, and especially, like, coming out. So, is it difficult to talk about something so personal as, like, who you love and what you feel about certain things in front of all these people that you don't know?
I feel that it's much, for me personally, it's much more scary talking to people, I don't know.
Closer to you?
No, not closer to you, but in, it's like me and another person and we're talking on a...
Instead of to everyone?
Yeah,
so on
I don't...
one-to-one, like...
Yeah, one-to-one ratio is a lot more scary to me because, I don't know. I have to see them more closely. I'm in a bigger group, it's, I don't know.
Yeah, I can agree. I don't think it's, for me, it's not a big deal to be up and presenting. I do it all the time. I mean, I was on a panel last year. I do conferences around the country. My partner and I both do speaking at conferences. So it's like, it's just part of life at this point. It's like, to me, it's, you can't, for
like identity and politics for this community are directly connected. You can't sleep on it. So it's like I'm always speaking. I'm always giving an opinion on panels and stuff. Like it's just part of life. So it becomes normalized. Even if you don't want it to be, I'm okay with it. But some people don't. But it becomes normalized to be there. And a lot of times in a defensive position as opposed to here in an educational. So I don't think it's that difficult. And it's still abstracted from my personal life. I'm not giving any personal details about my own life.
Yeah. And also, just to kind of do a bit of comparison here, for straight people, you know, able to easily tell, oh, that person's straight, is, you know, they're a girl and they like a guy, fair enough. That person is cisgender and they are a girl, fair enough. Like, it's not as much, like, it's just like a facet of who you are. At this point, it's
I feel like saying what gender I'm attracted to is more like saying, oh, I prefer this genre of music, or like, this is the kind of, like, I don't know, like, I prefer this brand of clothes. Like,
I'm sure sexuality is a bit more intimate than a mixtape.
Actually, I get a lot more nervous talking about the music than I like the gender I am. Like, yes. That's a touchy subject.
Hamilton?
I just got into that.
I've seen Hamilton. There's no shame in Hamilton.
What?
No shame at all in Hamilton. I've seen Hamilton. It's the best show.
Okay.
Yeah. And now we have turned into a Hamilton fan cast. Fun time.
I think when you believe in something so much and you're it's something very dear to your heart, it's a lot easier than talking about something that you're not so like educated on. Does that make sense? Like, this is something that I've held close to my heart for a long time, and it's a lot easier talking about it because I've talked about it so much to the point I'm just really comfortable with it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and you're the expert on yourself.
Yeah.
I would like to say, for me, it is a little bit difficult. That was a great question. Public speaking is a little bit difficult in the first place, and then to add something that's kind of personal, you know, for me it is harder than giving a book report. But it's also very worth it to be able to share with a attentive group of people how I feel, and, you know, to actually educate people. And another lesson we can take from this is to, you know, we don't all have the same opinion on everything, so when you speak, try to speak using I statements and share how you feel and not speak for our entire community or your entire community, whatever it is that you're talking about.
Yeah, can I add in briefly? I think a lot of times it gets taken that the LGBT community supports this or supports that. We are not an entity, we are a group of people. We do not vote as an entity, we don't speak as an entity, and we don't exist as one. We exist as one when we need organization, but only then. We don't all have the same views, and yeah, which is clear. I mean, we have debate up even between the six of us up here.
Alright, just a little stinger to ask you guys, and then, you know, anybody can ask a question after this. So, what are some actions that people can do to be allies? And allies, for all you guys who don't know, are, you know, like straight or non-queer identifying people, just like being cool friends to gay people or queer people. A little tired, you can tell.
This isn't really my question, I'll kind of pass it down more so. I mean, like, the only thing I have to say is, like, be supportive if a friend's trying to come out, comfort them, don't, like, urge them to if you suspect anything, just, like, do it on their time, not your own time, and be supportive of them. Most people will understand that you don't know everything, and it's not, like, you shouldn't be worried about offending people because you don't know what you're talking about, because everyone needs to learn, and you're not born with an innate knowledge of everything in the world. And that's pretty much all I have.
I actually wrote a couple things down for this question because it is important to me. unaccepting views towards our community or any identity in this community, speak up if you're comfortable and safe in the situation, and try to educate your friends and family members who don't understand, because it can get tiring as someone in the community having to educate other people. So if you can spread this knowledge, you know, throughout your little community, then that goes a long way. Try to challenge the assumptions that you make about other people and their perceived gender or sexual orientation when you see them. Try to assume less. Don't speak for people, and instead give their platform a voice if you can. Acknowledge that some identities have less privilege in society, for example, trans versus just being gay. Usually there's a little bit of a tougher time for gender identities, and then people who are both queer and a person of color, or queer and a woman, have a harder time, so keep that in mind. And then when you grow up and you think about who you're gonna vote for, or maybe bills that you're gonna vote for, referendums, try to think about the people you know who are queer and think about whether voting for a particular person will harm their safety. Those are just some ways that you can be good allies to our community.
I agree, especially with the part where she said that stand up for people if you feel comfortable. Like, you don't have to be a gay or trans rights activist to be an ally. Like, you can quietly support the community without having to be so outspoken about it. Like, not everyone feels comfortable with being outspoken in general. So it's just something to think about.
Yeah. My big thing is that you do not try and force someone to come out when they are not ready to, because that can definitely not only hurt your friend, but it can also sometimes damage your friendship or your relationship, because it's a very difficult, for a lot of people it's very difficult to come out, and they should do it on their own time. Don't, even if you know the person that they're worried about coming out to is going to be supportive, it's still always difficult because you're telling them about yourself that you, it's sometimes, my brain's not working right now. It's just difficult to come out and just let them do it on their own time. Really what I'm trying to say.
I feel like being an ally is just main rule, don't be mean. Don't ask invasive questions like, oh, like, what's in your pants? Are you gonna get the surgery? Like, don't do that. And I feel like ask questions. It's okay to ask questions. You shouldn't feel nervous about being uneducated. Just don't assume things. And if you're like, oh, I have a question, but it might be weird, I'm like, okay, like, I get weird questions every day.
And so this has just kind of come up for the whole ally discussion, where it's just like don't assume things, and also ask questions. We all kind of have to admit that as a community, for the most part, all right, LGBTQ plus people kind of get, when people use the wrong terminology, and like, we don't kind of react the best way in the world.
It depends on the person, really, because I don't get offended if you use she, her, he, his pronouns. They're just not my pronouns, and I will try to correct you if I feel comfortable enough. But I won't be like, no, you're wrong, that's insulting, that's humiliating, that's horrible.
Yeah,
I don't
people,
do that.
Some
that's,
people take it over the top like that.
Yeah.
But I feel like it's more of like, I don't know, some people are just
jerks.
Yeah.
Yeah, it depends on the person, really.
Like
everyone.
I'm not saying people in the queer community, like, will always be accepting, in any case, if you've come across like some mean people, just, I guess, it's the same as like stereotyping the rest of the community.
Yeah, I agree. Like, there's jerks in and out of the community. We're still human beings.
Yeah.
There's still a tendency to go that way. But I also, like, I think some people are really sensitive about it, but I also don't think we do, as a community, we really, like, strive to present our best selves, like,
yeah,
a perfect, like a perfectly refined community. I am the antithesis of perfectly refined community. I am blunt, I'm honest, and I'm not gonna hold back on anything. I mean, I don't care with identity. If someone says something and it's not actually what I identify as, whatever, I'll just tell them, it's not a problem. But I don't think we need to always be a perfectly refined community as well, just to appease.
Yeah, I get misgendered sometimes, and it doesn't bother me at all. And it bothers the people who find out more than it should. Like, don't feel bad, you know. I would just say everyone reacts differently, and the people who might explode if you use the wrong terminology, there is something causing them to be that angry, because they have had negative experiences, and it's really not too much to ask that you help educate yourself and use the right terminology. So, you know, maybe Parker thinks that people react too strongly, but that's one person's opinion, and it's not. Everyone is different.
That's kind of feel that everybody should. Oh,
question. Questions?
Yeah.
Hello.
Hi. I'm talking about the jerks thing you're talking about. I have a problem, and it's my age, which is a problem in itself. But when we're talking about pronouns, and I understand about them and there, but as a Latin teacher and a grammarian, the problem I have is that them and there are plural, and if I'm talking about one student, I can't bring myself to say them or there, and I don't know what to do. You know, I revert back automatically to his or her, but I know that's not right.
Well, dictionaries now are starting to define it singular, and it has been used singular
it's
in history.
Yeah. Right? Well, I have an example. If you, I feel like in, whenever I say, whenever I see, like, his or her, I'm like, 5 years of my life has just been taken away. Because it's so much easier to just say it there. Like, if someone, like, I don't know, leaves their phone in your classroom, you're like, oh, it's their phone. Like, you wouldn't be like, that's his or her phone. So you can, like, revert to, it's kind of just like, people are like, it's not grammatically correct, but also, you revert to gender-neutral pronouns when you don't know someone's gender.
Yeah, because I'm
like, especially if it's just an enemy that you just don't know.
Also, I understand, because there was a point in my life where it's kind of hard to kind of comprehend that, you know, they, them, theirs was a thing that you just kind of need to know. Just try to be a bit cautious when you're talking about that person. If you know that they use those pronouns, maybe try to refrain from using them. Maybe use their name when you're talking about them in the third person. And
that's my go-to, because sometimes I get flustered.
Yeah, my mom does that a lot. She'll be like, Andrew is going to Andrew's school today. Andrew, and I'm like,
no, I understand both. I get it, and I wish I were younger because I'd be more flexible.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a very,
have all your old knowledge locked down and learning new knowledge is tiring. Yeah.
It's a very valid issue for anyone, but it does kind of invalidate someone's identity. And I think that, especially as a teacher, you know, fostering a space where students can be safe and can be themselves is more important than, you know, 100, 200 years of, more than that, many thousands of years of language.
My one thing is that you just need to address them as something that they like. Like, if you cannot use they, them, use their name, I just have someone in my life who doesn't use anything. And it's confusing because I don't know if they're talking to me or talking to someone else, because they don't use anything. They don't use my name, they don't use my pronouns. They're just like, hey, you, come over here. And I'm just like, I'm with my friend.
point and call at me, and that's the one of the only things you can do that offends me, because it feels like I'm not important enough to have a name or pronouns, which is offensive.
Can I say something? So, it's kind of depending on, like, what you prioritize, I guess. Like, do you prioritize being grammatically correct or having someone feel comfortable?
Just as, like, a little ending note, just as long as you're willing to admit that you've made a mistake,
and that
if your heart is in the right place, and if you aren't trying to be mean, and if you catch yourself doing it, apologize, and if you can't do it, just recognize that you sometimes do something wrong, and then, yeah, it's kind of like a no-win situation, you know?
You had a question, right?
Yeah.
Like, I know that you can't, like you said before, you can't speak for everyone, but do you feel that, like, being a transgender, you have to get the surgery, or is that just, like, another way of informing?
No, you don't. It's different for everyone. Some people will never do the surgery, and some people will do top surgery, some people will
surgery. The surgery is kind of ambiguous, because there's, like, four different surgeries. I'm more inclined to go on hormones, which is like testosterone. It's an injection, and it's like you can deepen your voice. It like gives like facial and body hair, and it just makes you feel more masculine. It's easier to present that way. I feel like sometime I do want a breast reduction, but that's also like a couple grand, and I'm not really.
I think for me, as a trans individual with a partner that's trans and another kind of partnery friend that's trans, like my whole like inner circle is to an extent that it's a matter of self-alignment to self than self-alignment to society.
Yeah.
And
yes.
For me, yes, I do want to, but no, my partner does not, because going the other way, transitioning, it's not as well developed scientifically. So there's generally less desire, and it's a person by person basis.
Yeah, and also when you do the surgery, there is amount of risk that you have to take, because with top surgery for female to male, it can be very dangerous, because there has been some accidents happening, and you don't have a nipple. They're gone.
Yeah.
Oh, you only have one. Which is scary, and it's
pretty expensive.
Yeah, and then it's just a surgery.
Because it's not like covered by healthcare or anything.
No.
Like, you get your appendix removed, that's like, I don't know, a certain. I've never had my appendix removed.
It's not fun. It's not fun.
Yeah. But it's like not something people are like, this is a medical priority. It's like, this is just something, like, it's like plastic surgery. It is technically plastic surgery, so it'd be something you pay out of pocket for. And it's also just kind of like, not, I don't see it as a necessity, especially being like a literal child. I like maybe later, but not. I'm not really thinking about it right now.
Yeah.
I just forgot what I said.
Another part of it is like the medical aspect of it is, and like the monetary aspect is, yes, it's expensive, and for a lot of trans people they can't afford it. It's like a lot of trans people are struggling to keep a home and a job, and it's like I have a lot of friends who are mid-20s in their 30s from a different group I work with, and they're like just trying to keep their home and their job, let alone stay up with hormones and stuff. So they skip weeks and stuff like that to be able to make ends meet. It's not an easy thing for a lot of them. Also,
it's very nervous to get surgery right now, because the surgery might change, and it might get better, and it might get easier, and it might get less expensive, and it might do a better job, and might leave you with less scars, and you just want to wait to see if that will ever happen, if those progresses will ever happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Also, just as a little ending note, because I see your question in the back, maybe?
Yeah.
Just as like a general like grammatical thing, say transgender person, not call somebody a transgender. It's like calling somebody a gay. It's just like, oh man, that's slightly 70s. like you know, transgender person, gay person, not a transgender or a gay.
Because it's more of an adjective.
It is more of an adjective.
So instead of saying
trans
person, it's just a trans person.
Yeah, and before we go into another conversation, question in the back.
Them and just don't understand them.
On a lighter note, I want people to understand that, like, we're still people, and, like, we're not just gay, or we're not just trans. Like, I personally, like, that's not all I am. Like, there's so much more about me than just being gay or being agender. Like, we're people, we're not, like, these mythical beings.
I do meet all the criteria.
If you don't care about rights because, like, if you don't care because it doesn't, like, apply to you, just see, like, different parts of the person. Like, I'm an artist. I, like, I'm aspiring, like, I want to be a medical student. And just be like, oh, that's a person who is interested in things and could be life-saving if I become a surgeon. And I feel like that's more of, like, I have other things about me, like you said, like, I'm not just gay or trans.
Just as a little ending note, because I'm going to try to get one more question, just be nice to people.
Yeah.
Like, seriously, don't be a jerk. Be nice to people.
It's a
cool thing.
We can take, can I just add in one,
sure,
one last thing? Yeah, for me, it goes back to, like, the political aspect of it. I think people need to be educated about our community because we're under attack as a whole in this country. And you look at me and you probably think I'm a pot-smoking liberal. I look like one, I'm pretty left. But I am a hard believer in gun rights because I believe that I need to be able to protect myself against people who are against the community.
Way down the rabbit hole.
Like, it's
a final question, no more rabbit hole. Oh, God.
Quick question.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, that's quite literally true.
Very real.
Like,
no.
It's not just Russia.
Yeah.
Lots
yeah,
of
many
places.
Countries.
I feel like there's, like, only about 7 countries where you can be put to death.
It's literally illegal.
Yeah.
Oh,
God.
Like,
Russia. No.
Nobody does. It's very cold there.
I would say just
take,
cool. take away the fact that even though America is sort of at the front of this issue in the world, and we have come a long way in the past 100 years, we're not all the way where we need to be for the safety of our community, and just because the hate has shifted forms doesn't mean that it has disappeared.
And I think we need to do a better job of, like, reaching out to other countries and enforcing, like, we've tried at UN to make LGBT rights just a staple of civil rights, and we failed. And I think as a country, we do a very bad job of enforcing it in other countries and actually protecting people because we're too afraid to offend other countries or other religions. But
I think that's it. Yeah.
Anyone else? Questions?
We have, like, less than 1 minute. Yeah.
And it's okay, like, if you have more questions and you see me outside of class,
yeah.
be like, hey,
yes.
I saw you at that panel. I have a question that didn't get answered.
Yeah.
Yes, definitely.